money. So they're going to be passing some offering baskets around so you can help defray the cost of tonight and say thank you to Reverend Hagler. What a wonderful talk. And the second opportunity is to ask questions. And we have people with paper and pencils for you to write the questions out. We're going to do this like they do at Chautauqua. And so you can write out your questions. So the plates are passing around, and we have people with paper and pencils. And get ready to write your questions, and we'll ask them. Is Josh still here? So if you want to ask him a question too, I guess he'd be open to receive it.
Resistance of policies such as to go to Cuba when you didn't supposed to go to Cuba, talk to people and governments when the United States wasn't talking to them. One of the accusations against me was that I met with President Ahmadinejad. Yes, I met with him. Right? That's the thing to do. I believe that you can talk about everything and anything. But there's a difference in terms of when it comes down, if you look at the current fabric in Israel, you see that there's actually a vibrant debate that goes on from many of the peace groups trying to raise up questions. But there's also an apparatus that has become so oppressive, such as right now the debate over this new anti-terrorism law, and it says something like this. If you sold your automobile to someone, and that someone goes a year later, 2 years later, and use that automobile for a suicide bombing attack, that person will probably be killed, but then you face 30 years in jail for selling them the car. Now you gotta ask, what sense does that make, other than that is really, in a sense, trying to victimize Palestinians and even close down part of the economy that exists. I mean, so that's government. I pray that people will stand up against draconian laws and against those kinds of policies and acts and oppose them. We don't see that strongly right now from the citizens of Israel. It's just like right now you had an attempt to take over the Dome of the Rock on the Temple Mount. And folks young folks basically barricaded themselves in the mosque. And so they claim that the Israelis, IDF showed up because there were people barricading themselves in the mosque. Yeah, there were people barricading themselves in the mosque because a whole gang had showed up to take the mosque. I mean, so it's literally how things get twisted up and told so strangely. I'll tell you another piece, in that in occupied territories, they said that, I believe it was that, if you're Palestinian and you have a farm or land, you don't work the land, I think, for 5 years, right? It's considered abandoned and can be confiscated. So there's roving gangs roving around and shooting at Palestinians they catch working their land to try to make sure it's not worked for 5 years. That's part of what's going on in the society. You got also a settlement culture that is expanding continuously, so that you no longer have a contiguous territory. That's what makes this idea of a two-state solution ludicrous at this time. Because you got basically Israel occupying, and you got settlements that are continuing to expand. A settlement that can set up as a temporary place, and then it begins to take on permanence, and then it begins to expand and take over more and more territory in occupied land. That's what's going on. And so that's a part of the citizens of Israel. And so again, we have to begin to ask and be clearly raise our voices when people do not stand up for what is unjust. I remember when we were dealing with South Africa and folks did not want to hear us deal with South Africa. I think many of y'all came on the South African struggle a little later on after it gained momentum. But when I started with the South African struggle, everybody shouted you down. And particularly preachers. It was interesting. Preachers shouted you down. Right? And then somebody will always bring up, particularly when Idi Amin was in office, they would say, well, what about Uganda? What about Uganda? Right? He's a dictator. He needs to be out. Right? But that's beside the point. I'm talking about South Africa right now. Right? But it was always people look for an excuse not to deal with what should be dealt with. And that takes place all the time in Israel as well. There are some, I'll say this, when we caught up with the African refugees in Tel Aviv, there was a strong group of Israeli women that were there working to support them. And very, very valiant in terms of their work with them. So you can't take any broad brush on anything. There's always nuances and always, thank God, there's always people of conscience and goodwill and bravery who's gonna step up to the plate and do the right thing. And I just pray that that increases drastically and rapidly over time so that we can get to that place where we have fairness and balance in the world.
There are strong women in Israel doing that as well.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Yeah. We have another question. How can we respond to the argument that is often made, especially by people of faith, that occupation is a justified response to the behavior of members of a population and or its leadership?
That reason that argument doesn't work because here is in occupied territories, Israeli settlers are under civil law. Palestinians are under military law. It is not a response to the behavior of Palestinians. The IDF is there to protect settlements that are planting themselves and continuing to expand. That's why there's two separate ways in which law is done when it comes to Palestinians or Israeli settlers. Because it's really all about, right now, expanding the territory. In fact, the person who was in the IDF, who was talking to us, he pointed out that there had been a plan to basically take over the occupied lands because the argument was that we can create a buffer state, between us and Egypt, and us and the neighbors to the north, right? So we need to take over land in order to have that buffer state. Well, that was an argument, a convenient argument, that was put in place with which to annex territory and just continue to justify taking it over. There's no way in the world we can basically say, oh, the Palestinians deserve what they got. We could say that if we were to use that type of equation, we should say the Native Americans deserve what they got, but that's not the case. Right? And the fact is that people deserve to be free. And what behavior you're talking about, just think of the narrative. I wanted to point out something. Gaza is totally blockaded. It's blockaded by sea, by air, and by land. Tunnels were built into Egypt in order to bring in food and building supplies and medical supplies and all those other types of things. Right? And of course, I'm sure some weapons moved through those tunnels. But that was not the primary use of those tunnels. When Egypt went to close it up, it was really taking away people's food in a lot of cases, medicine in a lot of cases, building supplies, etc. So when Fox News got it, Fox News and basically the American news took it right off of an Israeli press release and just referred to them solely as terror tunnels. Terror tunnels, so nobody would question that you bombed the hell out of Gaza. Nobody would question the number of people that was killed. But those were survival tunnels before the narrative changed into terror. But again, we got to watch where the language comes from, who is using the language, how it's used, and we got to be able, and clear enough, to be able to re-articulate and tell the truth.
What about the indigenous struggle from indigenous people whose land is also being occupied?
Which indigenous people are we talking about? All right. In Washington, D.C., one of the things that we work with is the Oneida Indian around changing the name of the Washington football team. And that's a hard battle with Washington, D.C., y'all. But to change it, why? Because basically Native folks are saying the name's offensive. And they tell you why it's offensive. And everybody turns around and they say, well, it's not offensive. You shouldn't be insulted. It's a thing of honor. And then they tell you that it was a ransom that was put on bringing red skin in because you were clearing off the frontier. Right? So you were paid to kill them. And that's what was going on. But and I'm bringing that up because, again, it's like, who controls the narrative? Who controls the narrative always controls the outcome. And we've been working because the issue is we're trying to stand in solidarity also with indigenous people, not only here, but around the world. And the thing that I've learned to try to not be an oppressor myself is I can't define what people feel, and I can't define what people tell me is important. All I can do is look at people, listen to them, and then basically stand in solidarity with them. I can't second guess people. I'm not in that place. Just like I can't second guess women. Unless I have ovaries, I can't second guess women. Women tell me it's sexist, it hurts, I gotta believe it. And therefore, that's the same way that we have to approach folks in the world. Is to hear their hurt, take it seriously. Don't try to dumb ourselves down and dumb everybody else down by trying to make it something that it is not, but it's exactly what people say that it is. So we need to respect indigenous people. But also, I want to point out, one of the things that was interesting was that if you go through the occupied territory, you see a whole lot of rocks, hills, and stuff like that. And I was looking at them going, what are all those rocks there for? So I was talking to somebody, and somebody pointed out and said, that's not just rocks, that's a farm. And I go, oh, we do terrace farm. We've been doing that for thousands of years. And then when you look closely, you realize, yeah, it is a cultivated farm, not in the way that we're used to seeing farms, but in the way in which indigenous people work with the land. And then you cross over on the Israeli side and you realize this, that there's a different worldview. And the worldview is, if they can, the Israeli side has bulldozed mountains so that they have flat farms. Flat farms that can produce, sure, more produce and more food. But what comes with that, just think of it, is a mentality that we can conquer the land, you can remove mountains, you can change the geography, which means that everything else follows, right, in terms of your attitude about everyone else and everything else. One of the things as a man of faith that I understand is I am nothing but an ant in creation.
Right.
I am dependent upon this earth that God has offered. Right? I'm dependent in such a way that I can't control it. I can't remake it in my own image. I have to learn to respect it and learn to live upon it. Something that my ancestors knew. I didn't necessarily know that growing up in a Baltimore in the city. Something that my grandmother knew very well, right? She knew how to heal me with herbs. She knew stuff that doctors don't even know today because she was a woman of the earth.
Question reads, I am unwillingly and unintentionally a person of privilege, a white male professional. What can I do to erase this privilege to help to create a world of true equality and opportunity and treatment for all people?
Well, can't erase who you are.
Right.
But what you can do is you can stand up and make choices on behalf of others. Make choices that empower other folks. Make choices that lift up other people. Make choices that brings truth to life. It's just like very often we get around and we don't want to talk about things like race, Palestine, stuff like that, because we want to keep the conversation nice and civil. The fact is because we keep the conversation nice and civil, those things continue to exist. People are not confronted with having to deal with them. People can stay locked in the lies that they're locked in. So to be a person of privilege or not even a person of privilege, we need to all stand up, speak up, and tell the truth, and cause the devil to be shamed.
Two questions about Black Lives Matter. The first, all lives matter. Yes, black lives matter very much. What about black fathers, not the ones who are absent, but the fathers who want to take care of their children but are being hindered due to the court system, and mothers and the mothers' rights? How do we move past this? And the other question is, I love the idea of Black Lives Matter, but what about the lives of the unborn? And we talk about solidarity, doesn't that include the extermination of our babies at more than five times the rate of whites? And you include in your all black lives matter even in the womb?
That's a nice loaded question. I believe and a woman's right to choose. All the lies and crap that's being made up on Planned Parenthood also need to be exposed. Because in many cases, that's the only place a lot of women go to get health care. So when you want to close that down, you really deny women the kinds of health care that is needed. I respect all life at all stages. It's always interesting when somebody raises that issue because I find very often that people care about the unborn child, but don't do too much caring after they get here. Schools that don't teach. We got prisons and court systems that are basically making money off of locking us up. And it just goes on and on down the road that way. So there's not very much statement that folks care about other folks at all stages of their lives. And if you really believe in all life, then you have to be opposed to the death penalty too. That's just being consistent. You ever notice how inconsistent we are? Right? That we argue this, but we say, but, I mean that. Right? No, we've got to be consistent across the board. Right? And part of it is that we continue to be inconsistent as a culture and as a society. You know, I listen to these politicians that they talk to. They don't believe half of what they say. Right? They are playing, and hear this, because people get mad every time I say this. They're playing to an angry white mob out there who is angry ever since President Obama got elected. They're angry. They're insanely angry. When Dylann Roof went into the church in Charleston, he said that he had to stand up because there was no real Klan anymore, no real skinheads, and somebody had to do something. And he killed folks in that church. Did y'all know that that was the anniversary when Denmark Vesey was arrested and folks were hung from that church and the church was burned. He went in on the anniversary. So he had, and he was clear in his mind what he was doing. It's always interesting how folks want to say at some point, well, you know, he's just sick in the head. No, he wasn't sick in the head. He represented a culture. A culture that said that only dead black lives matter. A culture that said we're going to harken back to the Confederate flag. And be mindful, y'all, you know, what y'all get so upset about the Confederate flag? Don't y'all realize it's a symbol of Southern heritage? That flag didn't go up in most of those states until the Civil Rights Movement. It went up as a defiant statement to the Civil Rights Movement that they said segregation now, segregation forever, and things ain't gonna change. And it flew there over the capital of South Carolina. It was a culture. Yes, it was a culture, but it's a culture of hatred, a culture of bigotry. It's a culture that said only dead black lives matter. I was reading something the other day, it was so funny. I know I'm off the subject a little bit, but it was so not funny, but it was sad. It was when Oscar the Priest was invited to the White House with his wife, since he was the only black in Congress. In the 20s. And a senator from South Carolina makes the quote to a mainline paper. He says, I think it's a shame that he invited him to the White House with his wife, and now we're going to have to lynch 2,000 niggas to put them back in their place. Quote unquote. The fabric of the country. Nobody thought that was extreme. Nobody thought that was out of place. It took and take good people to stand up and to denounce it in order to change it. We can pass laws all we want, but it takes people. Politicians wouldn't be pandering to Israel if we say, hold it a minute. Why are we sending all that money over there? Why do we send money there more than we do for the entire continent of Africa? Why are we arming them? Why do they thumb their nose at our president and we still arm them? Netanyahu carried off clearly what I call one of the most white supremacist stunts of the 21st century. It's like, Rep, if I was to go into somebody else's church, I'm gonna ask the pastor, is it okay for me to come? You know, they may have the chairperson of the deacons call me and say, oh, we want you to preach. Pastor, chairperson of the deacon board called me and said, they want me to preach. Are you in agreement with that? That's the way it works. Everybody understands that. So to basically go around and pass the president was saying to the U.S., he don't matter. He's black. We call the shots up in here. We don't even have to stop by the executive office of the president as a point of courtesy. We can simply do what we want, walk the way we want, and all that. Israel used to have a hotline to the Pentagon, but they didn't have to go through any protocol in order to order up weapons. They had a specially dedicated staff person who was the appropriation person for all the weapons. Obama got mad and said, we're going to look at every transaction from now on. So that's a part of what's going on when you see the tension between the two. I know I didn't answer the question, but that's all right.
This one's back to Israel-Palestine. If you feel a two-state solution is ludicrous, do you have an idea of a fair solution?
Actually, I do. Yeah, I didn't think I did, right? First part I want to say is that you can't have a democracy and call something a Christian country. I know folks want to try to make America a Christian country, but the minute you call it a Christian country, you have devalued everybody who's not Christian. And so in Israel, I don't know how you can have a Jewish state and call it a democracy. Because that means that you have relegated everybody who's not Jewish to second and third class citizenship. And I also don't believe believe you can have an Islamic Republic either, because you have relegated everybody who's not Muslim to second and third class citizens. So the first thing that we need to start with is kick religion out of any of these national political configurations, first thing. Second thing is that if you're going to exist the way you exist right now, allow every Palestinian to have a vote, if that's the way it's going to be right now. And you also allow Palestinians to have the same right that Jews have. Because you know Jews can show up from any place in the world and basically come and say, I'm home. Well, Palestinians lost their home, so they should be able to come back to their home. Come back in whatever numbers they choose to come back. And then be fully enfranchised in the process so that they have a say in what takes place in the country. That's how you begin to change it and undo it. That's what we had to do in South Africa, because South Africa, blacks could not participate. Blacks did not have a voice. Even though they were a majority, they did not have a voice. And so we had to deal with that. And that was one of the reasons we began to campaign to withdraw economic support from South Africa. Because we needed for South Africa to feel the pain of disinvestment so that they once again could join civil human community. And that's what needs to happen in the state of Israel right now.
Some of the most vocal support for Israel by U.S. quote Christians, unquote, is just a mask for, or just a means of masking deep Islamophobia?
Well, fundamentalism of any kind is always dangerous. And what that means is that people focus and they believe that they got the truth. You got a truth, I got a truth, everybody has a truth. Right? Sound like a song, right? But when folks begin to focus in terms of this idea, and just think how ludicrous John Hagee's idea is, because John Hagee gets a lot of money and has a lot of relationship with Israel. If you ever tune in, you see his church down in San Antonio, it's one of the mega churches, and Netanyahu is always in that hall. And then Netanyahu, always being in the pulpit, you would have asked, why isn't the IRS looking at his church in terms of violation of church and state? Or why doesn't he have a license as a foreign agent of a foreign government? Yeah. Right? Those are questions that. But Hagee's argument is we got to protect Israel at all costs. Israel can't do anything wrong. Because if we protect Israel, then eventually the Messiah will come. Jesus will come. And Jesus will convert everybody to Christianity and send all the rest to heaven. And so that serves very well. That serves very well. The whole Zionist state. Because you got all of these Christians running around talking about, oh, we got to deal with Israel, we got to protect Israel, we got to all of that type of stuff. But the fact is when it comes down to understanding what this Israel is like Liberia. Liberia was meant to be the U.S. beachhead in Africa. That's why it was called Monrovia and all those other places. And it was also established, first of all, as a place where freed slaves were supposed to go. Because you didn't want that problem in the U.S. So it was a beachhead. And so Israel is a beachhead for Western powers, a beachhead that does business in the Middle East, a beachhead that basically is a place that does commerce and also sell arms. And so again, you know, we got to realize what we're dealing with. That's a whole lot of movement going on.
Can you talk about the influence of the National Rifle Association?
Guns. Right? I mean, that's all I can really say. The National Rifle Association basically pumps firearms not only into our cities, into our country, but also are an agent for pumping guns around the world. That's why, when you look at it, it's all of this armament. Wars are really an opportunity to trade weapons. and to sell bigger and bigger weapons and more bullets and more guns. And that's just the way it breaks down. So a lot of profit in war, right? A lot of the armaments deals don't believe there's a lot of profit in peace. But I'm one that wants peace. I want to reconstruct a world where people can live together. We don't need to be on a battlefield. We don't need to be pointing guns at each other. But I need to see each other with dignity and respect in order to get there.
One last question, and our great thanks to you.
Thank you.
How has the narrative around the Jewish Holocaust contributed to the violence against Palestine? And I would add, what new narratives do we need to craft?
Listen to the word, first of all. The Holocaust. I may get in trouble for this, okay? When we say the Holocaust, why are we always only talking about what happened in Europe in World War II? My people had a Holocaust coming over in the Middle Passage. Native Americans had a Holocaust. Armenians had a Holocaust. You can go right on down the line, just about every region in the world, every nationality, every country, each of them had a Holocaust. But so why is this the Holocaust? I'm not denying that there was a Holocaust, but I'm saying it's not the, because there were a whole lot of others that have taken place in the world. But what it's used as is a part of a political argument. Because basically it changed the world that didn't act, the world that didn't respond, the world that ignored it into silence. Where is that world? That world is largely Europe, United States, who knew what was going on was going on, but basically ignored it as far along as they could ignore it until there was this huge, huge, tremendous tragedy that had taken place in the world. But it's not the only Holocaust there is. But it's conveniently, it's a political reality that basically shuts down the discussion about the whole issue of Israel. That's why folks can get away with the argument that we are people without a land and Palestine is a land without a people. Everybody in the world knew that to be a lie. Everybody knew that that was just a scheme used in order to get that land. And so one of the things that we got to be clear about is we honor everybody who's been through something like that. We honor all. We don't deny it. We don't get caught up and say, oh, it didn't happen. But at the same time, we got to realize that there were Holocausts that happened to other people as well, and there's a Holocaust right now going on against the Palestinian in the West Bank. I'm having a gathering on the 30th in Washington, D.C., and at somebody's house, a Palestinian's house, with church members. And her father's just happened to be coming in town. And her father fled with his family when he was 4 years old in 1948 and went up to Lebanon to get out of the fighting. The whole family fled to get out of the fighting. The war ended. The country no longer existed and they couldn't go home. He lived in that refugee camp in Lebanon from the age of 4 until he finally left to go off and try to do something with his life in the world. That's a Holocaust.
Thank you so much, Reverend Hagler. I think it's time.
I have a question.
I don't have a question. I have a comment. Would you allow me to
please?
Thank you. I am Palestinian. I am so happy. I am so proud to be here. I am very thankful to the Jewish Voice for Peace to invite that gentleman. And I am so happy from my heart to thank the brave man, the strong man who have the strong voice for peace and justice. And you allow me to shake your hand, please.
Thank you so much for that wonderful moment.
I think some of you picked not all that many left back there, but there's still some on the table. The first film starts this Sunday. It is a, it's a wonderful film, The Wanted 18, and it's about cows. And it's at 2 o'clock at the Little, and then there is a film at 6:45 on Monday, and then again the following Sunday. And Monday, and thank you everyone for coming. We so
times, tales from the dark side, evidence of the settlements on my hard drive. Man, I swear my heart died at the end of that car ride. When I saw that checkpoint, welcome to apartheid. Soldiers wear military green at the checkpoint. Automatic guns, that's machine at the checkpoint. Tables not M16s at the checkpoint. Fingers on the trigger, you get leaned at the checkpoint. Little children, grown adults and teens at the checkpoint. All your papers better be clean at the checkpoint. Gotta put your finger on the screen at the checkpoint. And pray that red light turns green at the checkpoint. And Martin Luther King had a dream of the checkpoint. He wake with loud screams from the scenes at the checkpoint. Is Malcolm X by any means at the checkpoint? Imagine if your daily routine was the checkpoint.
And Martin Luther King had a dream of the checkpoint. He wake with loud screams from the scenes at the checkpoint. Is Malcolm X by any means at the checkpoint? Imagine if your daily routine was the checkpoint.
Separation walls that surround in the checkpoint. On top is barbed wire like a crown on the checkpoint. Better have your permits if you found at the checkpoint. Gumming on the tower, aiming down at the checkpoint.